Well, good morning. It is a beautiful Easter morning. We welcome you who are here in the sanctuary, and we also welcome those who are home on Zoom and on the telephone conference call. It was a gorgeous morning when I drove in. It was still really misty, and some of the valleys, you know, you kind of had to go slowly through, have the lights on, and then you come up into the sunlight. It was so beautiful, and all the flowers that are blooming, the daffodils out front, you really know that it's alive. And yet often around the world, there are so many people who are sad and upset and angry at life. How wonderful that we have a message that endures even the greatest sadness, even the greatest defeat. How wonderful to be here for Easter. Well, Jonas Sterner is here. Oh, Jonas was here this morning, not here in the building, but at 6 o'clock, he did the sunrise service. And it was even before sunrise. And he was out there and gave this wonderful message, and that was appreciated. Oh, and I shouldn't forget the fact that yesterday there was this amazing Easter egg hunt for the kids, and there was tons of kids downstairs, and Sue Barnhart got up and said, you know, I think we have 1,500 eggs out there, some incredible number of eggs for them to hunt, and they found them. I mean, it was amazing, and they were just having a great time running out there and finding the Easter eggs, a sign of spring, a sign of Easter. Well, anyway, I'll stop talking, and Jonas has a beautiful prelude, and I'll let him play it. That was beautiful, Jonas. Thank you. And Mindy Sterner is here to be our worship leader to guide us through the call to worship and other parts of the service. Thank you.
You're welcome. Please join me in the call to worship. Have you ever had a day that did not feel like the joy of Easter morning? Did an unexpected turn of events get the best of you? If you believe that God raised Jesus from the dead, can you trust God enough to look for the hope that God has in store for you? If you believe that God raised Jesus to new life, can you see that there might be a new future for you? Let us gather and worship the God who moves in a mysterious way.
Be seated. Let us come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, it's Easter, and we can hardly remember or picture what the earliest Easter was like, but it started out as Jesus dies on a cross. He suffers a horrible death, and then suddenly, 3 days later, people see something strange has happened. Women go to the tomb that's supposed to be sealed and it's empty. And they're terrified that it's empty and they run away, confused. Mary Magdalene is looking to bring spices to the tomb to anoint the body of Jesus. Doesn't know how she's going to get the tomb open, but it's open and she can't find him. And she goes to the gardener and says, "Where have you put my Lord?" And he says, "Mary." And she says, "Teacher, teacher, it's almost so impossible to believe that it's Jesus alive." She runs back to the disciples, and then they run and see John and Peter. And indeed, the tomb is empty. And one of them is puzzled, and the other believes. It's just a series of stories like that, Lord, of people seeing strange things happen and amazing surprises. Sometimes, Lord, we don't think we can be surprised anymore because life is hard. We see death around us. We see people discouraged and disappointed, and we see terror in different parts of the world and wondered how any good can happen. And yet, Lord, you are the God of surprises. You are the God that makes amazing things happen. You are the one that opens possibilities that we never thought were possible. And there we are. We're surprised. Coincidence, maybe? Or perhaps, Lord, the more we trust in you, the more we believe, the more we open our eyes, we see those coincidences happening more often. Dear Lord, we thank you that you are a God that just wasn't a story in the Bible 2,000 years ago, but you're alive today, and you're helping us each day to guide us through this craziness called life. Dear Lord, we thank you that we can pray for people on our prayer list, because so many people want to be part of it. And when you've ever been sick and someone prays for you, it feels just wonderful, especially when you know it's a whole church full of people. And Lord, we pray for those who are sick. We pray for the doctors and nurses who care for them, because that's not an easy job. We pray for people who are encouraging them. And we know, Lord, you have a way of nudging that healing along and making life so much better. And dear Lord, we ask your blessing on all those who don't see their faith as a private reserve, but it's a gift you've given us to share with others, a gift not only of our belief, but our faith in you and our caring that we give to people in need and helping folks to feel that there is a God at the universe, in the center of the universe, who is all about love. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings you give us. In Jesus' name, amen. And now Mindy is back to guide us through the first part of our prayer list.
Please join me in prayer for Buzzy Baker, Reverend Julie Bell, Ron and Barbara Dice, Jean Eckenrode, Joan and John Fabula, Violet Farmer, Christine Fisher, Steph Fry, Connie Grosskost, Roger and Cindy Helmers, Ray and Gloria Henry, Sally Hill, Sally Caltrider, Reverend Dwight Mays, Patricia Moore, Jane Nace, Sandra Puderball, Mike Rennell, Tony Reif, Deb Ruth, John Sorrenti, Linda Spangler, Ann Stone, Miss Terry, and Charles Van Squeak Sr. We give praise for improvement for Linda Bupp, Angie Caltrider, Mary Forbes Miller, Stephen Forbes, Virginia Souter, and Judy Ellison. And then we pray for the family and friends of Eva Boyer, David Esch, Joyce Ilgen Fritz, Nancy Robinson, Eileen Snyder. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Your offerings can be mailed to Cindy Forbes at her Spring Grove address. Sunday school offerings can be sent to Neil Rohrbaugh at his Spring Grove address. Church envelopes and offering plates for both Sunday school and church are at the back of the sanctuary.
Offering all that we have. love to you, we are an offering. We are an offering.
Let us come before the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, when we were children, we remembered when our parents were doing something that looked really interesting, perhaps cooking something or fixing the car or making a repair. And we said, Mom, Dad, can I help? Can I help? Can I help? And they might have said, no, you're not ready yet. Or they might have said, yes, you can. And we were so excited to be part of that good work. We thank you, Lord, that you have called us to be your helpers, to be your agents in the world, to be people who are the ones who share your goodness, that help others see the hope at the end of the tunnel, the light at the end of the tunnel, to be those people who speak of their faith. Bless the gifts we bring, both with our money and with our whole being. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Now, will the children please come up for this morning's children's story? Oh, we got quite a crew here today. Wonderful. Let's see. Let's see who's here. What's your name, sir?
Elijah.
Hi, Elijah. What's your buddy's name?
Blue Raspberry.
Blue Raspberry. Cool rabbit. All kind of blue
I
and white.
Exactly like that, except mine is purple, and mine, I guess I'm just going to call her Gina for now.
We're not violent.
No.
That's nice. And what's your name, miss?
I'm Maggie.
Maggie, that's right. I'm an old guy. You have to remind me. You know. And what's your name, miss?
Tessa.
You don't have any stuffed animals with you today?
I have the same at Maggie's, but her name's Sparkle.
Sparkle, cool.
I'm Tessa's translator. She said she has one exactly like mine, except her name is Sparkle.
Sparkle. Bunnies. And what's your name, sir?
Henry.
Good to see you again, Henry. Yeah, nice of you folks to come up north. And your name, sir?
Ben.
Good to see you, Ben. So, tell me what day today is. Can anybody tell me what day today is?
Today's Easter Sunday.
Oh, that's right.
Speaking of Easter,
yes.
The Easter Bunny came last night for us, right, you guys?
Actually, the Easter Bunny forgot it to come to my house because he hid the baskets in my house, not outside.
He hid the baskets at your house.
Yep, and he didn't hide any Easter eggs. I guess he just wants to wait until I'm at church.
Yep, he's going to give them to you after church, I guess. That's so you won't have all that sugar in your body and be, yep. Yep. So what happened on Easter, besides the Easter Bunny?
Jesus rose from the dead again.
Yeah, pretty good deal, huh? Yeah, he went through some terrible suffering and everybody thought he was dead, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what happened?
He rose up from the dead again.
Yeah, he wasn't dead, right? Yeah, or he was, and then he wasn't. Yeah, pretty good. You know, sometimes, so what is it? What does that have to do with us? I mean...
He died for our sins,
yes. Anything else? Okay. So if God could raise Jesus from the dead, right, mm-hmm. What can God do for you? Could it be, have you ever had a time when you've got something really, really hard to do when you have no idea how to do it? You ever have those? Or maybe you have to deal with a brother or a sister.
Example.
Or you have to deal with somebody at school who's driving you crazy, right? And you don't know how to do, yeah. Or you have a homework assignment and you have this math problem and it's impossible to solve. It's just impossible.
You don't have math?
I'm like, I don't have math for homework. I have math.
That's good. Wow, we always used to have math for homework.
It's only my reading log now. So, I get the best teachers ever.
Yeah, that's cool if you get a reading log to do, yes. So what it means is if God can do amazing things like Easter, God can do things that can help you through your life. You know that? Like, let's say, because you know what happens to people is they get discouraged. They say, I'm never going to be able to do this. Any of your friends ever say that? I'm never going to be able to do this? Did any of your friends say that? Does your bunny rabbit say that? No? Okay. So sometimes people get discouraged and they say, I can't do this. Or people don't like me and I'm never going to have any friends. Or things like that. And did you know that God is working with you to help you through those situations? Did you know that? So whenever you have a time when you feel you can't do something or it's impossible, remember, God wants to help you. And let him do that. Okay? And now, are any of you actually going to eat any of that candy?
Probably a little bit later, yeah.
Yeah, probably.
Okay.
Wait, but we got chocolate clauses.
But not too much.
Not too much, yeah. Too much is too much.
Yeah, too much is too much.
Well, thanks so much for being here. It was really nice of you guys to be. Yeah. You can go back with your parents now, grandparents. Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever man may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Please join me in the scripture readings. The first scripture comes from Job chapter 19, verses 25. But I know there is someone in heaven who will come at last to my defense. The second reading comes from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 through 26. The walk to Emmaus. On the same day, two of Jesus' followers were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking to each other about how the things that had happened. As they talked and discussed, Jesus himself drew near and walked along with them. They saw him, but somehow did not recognize him. Jesus said to them, "What are you talking about to each other as you walk along?" They stood still with sad faces. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, Are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have been happening there these last few days?" "What things?" he asked. "The things that happened to Jesus of Nazareth," they answered. "This man was a prophet and was considered by God and by all the people to be powerful in everything he said and did. Our chief priests and rulers handed him over to be sentenced to the death, and he was crucified. And when he had hoped that he would be the one who was going to set Israel free, besides all that, this is now the third day since it happened. Some of the women of our group surprised us. They went at dawn to the tomb, but they could not find his body. They came back saying they had seen a vision of angels who told them that he is alive. Some of our group went to the tomb and found it exactly as the woman had said, but they did not see him. Then Jesus said to them, "How foolish you are! How slow you are to believe everything the prophets said! Was it not necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and then to enter his glory?" The third scripture comes from Romans chapter 8, verse 11. If the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from death lives in you, then he who raised Christ from death will also give life to your mortal bodies by the presence of his Spirit in you.
If you talk to people around the world, and people even who are other religions, Jesus always gets a pretty high rating. They may not believe all the beliefs that Christians believe, but Jesus is their guy. And why not? He did a lot of good for people. He helped people. He was somebody who would see someone who no one else would even talk to. He would feel their pain and do something about it. He was someone who would talk to people that everybody hated and often be able to bring them around, to forgive them, and to transform their lives. More than that, he was somebody who did amazing things nobody could explain, healing and helping people and touching people's lives. And so people really have a lot of respect for Jesus. They really read the Bibles and the stories in Scripture and think well of him. Sometimes, though, even when Christians come to church on Easter Sunday, that's a little harder for some folks because it involves a belief in something that we might think crazy. God raises Jesus from the dead. People don't raise from the dead. They just die, and there they are in the tomb, and that's it, we see. And so it can be kind of annoying even and aggravating. How am I going to believe this? This is just strange. I mean, how could you believe it? Well, I mean, people love science today. I love science. I love what technology and science has been able to do. And it's amazing the things that it can do in medicine and all kinds of aspects of our life. And yet, how would you do a scientific experiment to prove that Jesus had been alive after he was dead? I mean, you shouldn't go killing people just to see if they'll rise again. And we know from wars and such, they don't, right? They just die. And so you can't do an experiment. And more than that, if you're doing a scientific experiment, science deals with matter, energy, biological life. It's not about the will of God. It's not what God is doing. Or in some ways, science can have trouble figuring out what we're going to do. Have you ever found in yourself or maybe somebody else that you think you know a person and you don't think they're going to be able to do something and suddenly they shock you out of your life almost because they just do something amazing? And I remember when our kids were young and they would perform in a play or play musical instruments and that sort of thing. We think, whose kids are these anyway? They can't do that. You know, it's just unbelievable. And that's often the way it is, you know, that people will sometimes do things strangely. Well, if people can do things you can't expect, how about God? But again, how would you prove that? Well, I don't think you prove people by scientific experiments. You prove people and what they're like by being in a relationship with them. For example, I know this young couple, okay? And they met in high school, and they fell in love. And then they really found that they enjoyed each other's company. And they were doing things, all the things they loved together to do, and enjoying that. And then what happened is they both went off to college. And, you know, that's usually the end of high school romances. And everybody's a little sad, but they're going off into a new world. And they even went to different colleges. And then what happens is they kept in contact and they kept the relationship going. And then what happened is they came back. And, you know, sometimes when people have been, had a distant relationship and they're back again, well, that doesn't work out, but they really still like each other. They get along and they're just such a wonderful couple. And, you know, who would have thought, right? But the relationship was proved by them investing each other and caring about each other and always trying to do something that would make the other person happy. You know, in a relationship, you can't stand back and be this objective researcher. You can't say, what is he going to do next? Or what is she up to now? You've got to advance them credit. You've got to advance them the fact that they're going to be a good person. And strangely, as you live up to each other's expectation, then that's what happens. You become that. It's amazing. And so it's something you live, you invest in, and you care about, and you have faith in the other person. Well, what about God? Don't we come to know God through a relationship? Now you may say, well, what am I supposed to do? Imagine that God is my imaginary friend and just talk into air to God? Well, that's the way it feels at first, right? Because when you've got a real big problem and you're really upset about something and you pray to God about it, you know, it does feel in the beginning that you're talking into thin air. But when you put your heart and soul into it and you decide, I'm going to give God a try, I'm going to trust in God. But there's more parts to it than that. It's more than just the trusting. It's also looking for the answers that God is going to give you. And sometimes they don't come the way you think they're going to come. You may not get $100,000 that drops out of heaven, although I've known people who have. But it probably might come through somebody giving you good advice, or somebody helping you, or another person saying words that you were just saying to God and say, how do they know that that was my problem? And there they are. And it's really beautiful when it happens. But you've got to keep your eyes open. You have to expect God to help. And then you have to look for it to happen. One more part. You've got to be thankful. Most people get through their day and they're just tired and they want to go to bed and they're just grumpy. But you look back at your day and you see all the ways that good has happened, what God has done. And as you see all those good things that have happened, you say, wow, thank you, God. Thank you for what you've done for me. And then you get used to that. And then you build on that. And pretty soon, you know what happens? The idea that God could raise somebody from the dead is nothing, because what God has done for you on an everyday basis. Now, sometimes people don't believe that's happening because, you know, they had a certain expectation of what God was going to do and God didn't do that. We have our agenda. We want God to take care of it, please. And then we're going to be happy. But did you know that sometimes God has a whole different plan for us than you might think God does? It's strange. For example, let's take a doctor. Doctors work in hospitals today. And they're controlled by big corporations, and there's not enough money to heal, to hire people that are needed. Not enough nurses, not enough technicians, not enough anybody. And so doctors are working in a situation where things are crazy. You know, they need to get a test done, and there's not enough people in the lab to get it done. And you have to wait. What could take 45 minutes takes 3 hours. And this is the situation they're in. And they wonder, why am I doing this? Why do I bother? Why do I care? And what you discover is one day somebody says to this doctor, you know, you saved my life, doc. You helped me. You got me through that. And the doctor says, I guess I did. Or sometimes people don't even know the doctor saved their life because they're recovering and they're in pain and they don't think that they're going to be that well. And the doctor says, I saved that person's life. It really helped. And that's amazing, right? God has given you a purpose that's bigger than the purpose you think. It's not the purpose you always want. It's not the thing you started out doing, but God has a special place for you to do amazing things in this world. And if you look for that, and not just focus on what you want to do, let me give you an example. I know a woman who started out as a rocket scientist. I kid you not. Worked for NASA, did all kinds of work on satellites and systems like that. And that was going to be her life. That's what she wanted to do. Until her babies were born. Until she had her children. And she just loved those children. And you know, children aren't always perfect. They're not always easy to love, you know, but she loved them. And she did her whole heart into raising them. So they had all these educational and athletic and musical opportunities. And they just thrived in that environment. And she had this wonderful life that she lived and is still living. Yeah. So you see, God has a plan for us that's different than our own. And often it's better than the one we thought, but yet it's really tuned to who we really are as a person. But you know what's really hard sometimes is, you know, you're failing at something. But you may not be failing completely. It may be that you've done really, really well. For example, I know a young man who's a tennis player, and he is amazing. He's in his early years of high school. He beats seniors from his school and other schools on a regular basis at tournaments, even older people, and he is a star. In his local newspaper, he is on his pictures in the front page, you know, showing him doing some great athletic feat trying to hit the ball back, and he does great. But every now and then, he loses. Because whenever you're involved in a sport, there's going to be somebody better than you. But you know what he does? He doesn't get all down on himself. He doesn't get all upset about it. Instead, what he does is he says, what strategy was that guy using that I missed? Or what did I do wrong that I can do him better on? And he figures it out. And you know, in that way, he finds that this losing was actually a win, because in losing, he discovered what he could do better and make himself better at, and he does on a regular basis. So, you see, resurrection of Jesus was just something that happened a long time ago, but it happens in your own life too, because as you have this relationship with God, as you build it on a daily basis, as you see how God is there to help you and how God is there to guide you, it's an amazing experience. And then you discover that God has a different purpose than what you might have set out to be, but it was your real purpose in life. And it's so meaningful to you. And then even in failure, God is there to show you a new way. Ain't Easter grand? Yes, it is. God bless.
We're going to continue the prayers. Please join me in prayer again. Brad Arnold, Harry and Rose Auchinball, Tom Berry, Hazel Cowles, Flo Furman, Karen Gibbs, Eden Graham, Mary Lou and Donald Meckley, Lori Miller, Mary Forbes Miller, Shirley Miller, Manuel Nunez, Gary Vorbal, Shirley Russell, Rita Passmore, Brittany Starr and Baby, Corbin Taylor, Violet Smith, Lindsay and Caleb Oddhouse, Gail Ambrosius, David and Geraldine Ambrosius, Cindy Breeden, Joyce Greenfield, Isaiah Bulano, Brooks Case, Linda Huber, Missy Johnson, Carol Newman, Larry Oakes, Cameron Palmer, Irene Rabin, Kathy Russell, Brenda Schaefer, Darlene Worley, Gladys and Kenneth Wright, Virginia Albin, Karen Anstein, Jamie Aukey, Fred Baber, Jesse Betleon, Suella Caudry, Dakota Dixon, William Garman, Barbara Grossberger, Joanne Harner, Chip Hoover, Irma and Ruth Neller, Janice Neller, Kathy and Paul Neller, Fred Marsh, Dorothy Nagash, Don Riekert, Adam Shue, Jerry Shue Jr., Mark and Linda Scahan, Amos Strasball, Kenneth Strasball, Joanne Strewig, John Worley, Ron Yinglin. Those we keep in our continued prayers, Robert Anstein, Kevin Crum, William Dell, Dennis Falsey, Todd Gladfelder, Lester Heckler, Roger and Cindy Helmers, Joan Hensel, Dr. Mark Hirsch, Dolores Jones, Dustin Miller, Jeanette and Dean Rohrbaugh, Kathy Rohrbaugh, Mike Schmidt, Beverly Spite Mohammed, Shari and Kenyon Taylor, Larry Thomas, and Kim Wilson.
Come, people of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes to him. Where steady arms of mercy reach to gather children in. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Come those whose joy is morning sun, and those weeping through the night. Come those who tell of battles won, and those struggling in the fight. For his perfect love will never change, and his mercies never cease. But follow us through all our days with a certain hope of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Come young and old from every land, men and women of the faith. Come those with full or empty hands, find the riches of his grace. Over all the world his people sing, shore to shore we hear them call. The truth that cries out every age, our God is all in all. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice, 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 let every tongue rejoice, one heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice.
Be seated.
Please join us in the service of communion. Let us begin our communion as we continue the story of Cleopas and a friend discovering Jesus on Easter morning. The scripture comes from Luke chapter 24, verses 28 through 32. As they came near the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if we were going farther, but they held him back, saying, "Stay with us. The day is almost over, and it is getting dark." So he went in to stay with them. He sat down to eat with them, took the bread, and said the blessing. Then he broke the bread and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. But he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, "Wasn't it like a fire burning in us when he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?"
On that Easter morning, the disciples were surprised. They'd heard the rumors of Jesus' resurrection, but they didn't believe it. And then, as they're walking along, Jesus follows them down the road. They don't know it's him. They don't recognize him. And they come to the place they're going, and they sit down and have a meal together. And it's only in the breaking of the bread, when he tells them that they remember from his Last Supper, when he said, "This is my body broken, this is my blood spilt out," that suddenly they see him, they recognize him, and then he disappears. I bet they wish they had a camera to capture the moment, to prove to everyone that this really happened to them. But they didn't need to do that because people were having those experiences. As we gather before the table of the Lord, as we come to share this cup and this bread, may we cherish those moments of the Lord's presence. May we not have to take a picture, but know that the Lord is there and will be with us again. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this cup and bread. They are simple elements of the food we need and drink to help us to live in this life. But more than that, they are spiritual food that remind us of this meal, that remind us of Jesus' death and resurrection, that remind us, Lord, that you are here in our lives now, and we just need to keep our eyes open and be ready to recognize you at the right time. Bless this bread and this cup in Jesus' name. Amen. The bread that we break is the communion in the body of Christ. The cup of blessing that we bless is the communion in the blood of Christ. Come for all is now ready. Now, everybody's been given a little communion kit. Take off the first seal is the bread or the wafer, and then take off the next one and is the grape juice. And of those of you at home, I hope you have your communion elements prepared as well. Take and eat, for this is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood of Christ spilled out for you. Drink of it all. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we are so grateful to be at this table with you. This table you promised to be at forever with us, so that we can eat with you and dine with you and experience your presence. And whether we're here in other places, you are there for us, and we look for you and we wait. Bless us, Lord, with your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ has brought us over with hymns of victory. Our hearts be pure from evil, that we may see aright the Lord in grace eternal, of resurrection light, and listening to his accents, may hear so calm and plain his own all hail, and hearing may rise the victor strain.
Please join me in the benediction. Let us go forth with these words from Psalm 18. How I love you, Lord. You are my defender. The danger of death was all around me. The waves of destruction rolled over me. The danger of death was around me, and the grave set its trap for me. In my trouble, I called the Lord. I called to my God for help. In his temple, he heard my voice. He listened to my cry for help. Let us depart hopefully as we trust in the Lord.
Spread the good news throughout the land.
I invite you to be seated for just a few announcements. First of all, thank you to our worship team, Mindy Sterner, Jonas Sterner. You folks know each other? Yeah, of course you do. Yes, yes. And the choir, wonderfully done. Thank you so much. Beautiful. And our tech crew up on the tech desk, Gerald Shue there with the headphones on and keeping the sound right. And let's see, I see Jake Barnhart, and I see Ray Thacker, and there was a bunch of other people. Are they still there, or are they just hiding behind? No, that's it. Okay. Sometimes young people run the show. So anyway, thank you for all that good work. And the flowers are given this week in the glory, to the glory of God, in the honor of F. Donald Miller, whose birthday was on March 25th, and his granddaughter, Erin Olfin, who's, well, just one day apart, March 26th. No, Donald Miller, F. Donald is Donald Miller's. Yeah, I know. There's a lot of Donald Millers in the house, you know. So, there are, really are. And then, that's okay. You know how much I need correction, yeah. Anyway, happy birthday to them. We're collecting this month for socks. You know, socks seem like a simple thing, but if you don't have them or if there are big holes in your socks, it may not be too happy. So we bring these to Council of Churches and places like that. You are invited for the Vacation Bible School 2024, June 3rd through 7th, scuba diving with friendship and with God. And, you know, these Vacation Bible Schools are a lot of fun. The kids sing all these neat songs. They do all these neat crafts. So we hope you'll get your grandchildren, children, second cousin once removed, whatever. Yeah, that's good.
Can I share a little bit about
that?
Oh,
please do, Jonas,
next
yes.
Slide too.
Oh, next slide, yes, that's right.
Out at the vestibule desk in the front and at the desk here at the back, there are some cards. If you know somebody who might take an interest, share a VBS information card with them. It also has dates for Children's Day that they can come and explore what our church is like before VBS. Memorial Day dates are on there, and Sunday school picnic dates are on there as well to share with others.
Well, you guys are organized. That's impressive.
On here.
That's right. I know what you're saying. Yeah. Okay. We have children here, and in order to work with children or to be an employee of the church, you have to have clearances, and those are renewed every 5 years, and you have to take two courses online, which only take about an hour and a half, although people tell me, you're so slow, because they did it in like 15 minutes or something like that. So the information is on our email newsletter. Please read that and be part of doing that, because it keeps us safe and keeps the kids safe and keeps you safe. Happy birthday to Gloria Henry, and she is listening, I know, with Ray at the nursing home where he's getting rehabbed and getting better all the time, might be back soon, and Marjorie M. Trump. Marjorie, sorry, she's over there in the corner. Yeah, okay, there you are. Oh, there you are, right in front of me, okay. I need help. Anyway, happy Easter. I hope you have a wonderful time with your family, your friends, and keep the faith. Jonas has a postlude. Is that right?
I do.
Good. Okay.